into practical applications for designing appropriate rehabilitation and strengthening programs for prehab. So here we're not expecting to discuss the whole periodization or the whole phase of strengthening. We're just on before the strengthening phase. Okay? So what is prehab? I searched, there are a lot of definition of prehab, but the easiest definition is also called prehabilitation, where is it a form of strength training aims to prevent injuries before the actual occurrence. So it's just more of injury prevention, okay? But is it limited to athletes only to prevent injuries? Actually, no. According to Banugo, in his studies, it is a process of enhancing individual's functional capacity to enable him or her to withstand a forthcoming stressor. So a stressor may either be an injury or a major surgery. Okay, so for example, if the athlete has an ACL tear, it's like preparing his body to be for surgery, so that after surgery he will have more favorable outcomes. Another example is this. In a systematic review of 1,245 patients who underwent pre-operative exercise therapy before cardiac and abdominal surgery, had short hospital stays and reduced post-operative pulmonary complications. So the prehab is not just limited by musculoskeletal and orthopedic patients. Even with patients who will undergo cardiac and abdominal surgery, or those, for example, shoulder surgery, if they underwent preoperative exercises or therapy, they have better functional outcomes after surgery. So it's like preparing your body for surgery. Also, there's a clinical recommendation by the study of Phil Bay and his colleague in 2016 that exercise therapy before ACL reconstruction is required rather than early ACL reconstruction. So they're saying that those who have acute ACL injury and those with baseline cartilage and meniscal injury, meaning their cartilage, the one that absorbs the shocks between the bones, they have better outcomes if they will go prehab or pre-exercise therapy before undergoing reconstruction. So individuals also with more severe pain symptoms, more impaired function in the early post-injury phase are favorable candidates for prehab. So they may benefit from postponing surgery and recommending exercises, therapy before considering need for ACLR. Because sometimes when a patient has an MRI, or if he or she was diagnosed by a doctor, they will actually look for the earliest surgery dates, right? Because they want to get healed faster, but so they want immediate surgery. But the trend now, before the patient will go to any surgery, he or she must opt for rehab. Why? Because the outcomes for prehab, it's actually better. Plus, the acute symptoms like swelling, pain, range of motion limitation, they have faster recovery when patients undergo prehab first. They have, according to this study by Phil Bay, they have better knee outcome score, which is prognostic for better 5-year outcome. So after 5-year outcome, they have follow-up, and they discovered that those who underwent rehab has better outcomes or so compared to those who underwent surgery immediately. So before, like what I said earlier, doctors will diagnose first a need of surgery. Because we physiotherapists, we don't say that you need surgery, you have ACL tear. It should come from a doctor. And then when they diagnose, like, for example, a complete tear of rotator cuff, the patient will need to go to surgery immediately. But as an alternative practice, this one is becoming more popular, and hopefully more orthopedic surgeons are actually be more open-minded to advise patients to undergo prehab first. Because not all orthopedic surgeons will recommend prehab. because they will just say patients to go to surgery immediately. That's the usual practice, right? Because this study, they're just emerging like for this decade, the importance of rehab, maybe just 5 years ago, but it is not really used for a long time. So now, as an alternative practice, diagnosis, after a diagnosis of an injury, the doctor will recommend prehab. So the one that we're doing prehab, it can either be a physiotherapist or those who are knowledgeable with strength and conditioning, but mostly it should be more of physiotherapists because they have more knowledge and management when it comes to handling acute symptoms, okay? But for strengthening phase, yeah, they can, when it comes to strengthening, they can actually have help or ask for help from a strength and conditioning coach. So after prehab, the patient underwent rehab already, we have two options. Either we will continue with non-operative management, meaning we'll continue rehab. For example, rehab in a span of 4 to 8 weeks, it's a prehab duration. If the patient has a better outcome, he can opt to non-operative or conservative management. So she or he can just continue doing the strengthening until he or she will be functional again. Or if rehab is not that successful, or if the patient feels that, or if the patient and the physical therapist or the doctor feels that the patient needs surgery, he will opt to do surgery. And then after surgery, that's where rehabilitation will go. So now, diagnosis, prehab, and then two options, non-op, and then surgery, and then rehab again. So that's the two option after prehab. Okay? Any questions so far?
Ya, ada yang mau bertanya, atau mungkin Rai bisa dikasih dulu ininya, apa namanya, apa yang dimaksud?
Summary?
Dari, ya, summary dulu. Oke, okay, Rai, silakan.
Ya, dari apa yang Charm jelaskan, tadi kita tahu bahwa prehab itu adalah preparing atau preventing. Jadi kita prepare atau kita mempersiapkan sesuatu sebelumnya, sebelum apakah dia perlu operasi atau dia perlu penanganan cedera yang lain, itu sebelumnya dilakukan prehab atau pre-rehabilitation. Nah, dari semua yang dilakukan dalam rehab, banyak hal yang sangat beneficial dari prehab tersebut. Apa manfaatnya? Yaitu kalau misalkan ada klien atau pasien yang melakukan rehab, itu bisa terbantu dalam menerima stresor atau injury yang kemungkinan akan terjadi di kedepannya. Lalu membantu juga di sebelum dan sesudah dia melaksanakan surgery tersebut atau operasi atau penanganan lainnya, karena akan membuat atau akan membantu akan mengadakan better outcome atau hasil yang lebih baik daripada tidak dilakukannya prehab tersebut. Salah satunya adalah ACL reconstruction. Atau ICL itu adalah anterior cruciatum ligamen, salah satu ligamen di lutut kita. Kalau misalkan ACL itu memerlukan dibantu diagnosa oleh dokter juga, direfer atau direkomendasikan untuk dia surgery atau dia harus operasi, maka dokter sebaiknya merekomendasikan dahulu untuk prehab. Hasilnya akan lebih baik daripada tidak melakukan prehab. Apakah itu acute symptom-nya, seperti acute symptom itu symptom-symptom atau keluhan-keluhan yang baru terjadi seperti nyeri, merah, bengkak, dan lain-lain. Seperti itu. Salah satu dari outcome yang dari ACL atau lutut, cedera lutut adalah ada KOS namanya. KOOS itu adalah salah satu panutan kita buat melihat ini hasil skornya berapa, skor kemampuan si lutut itu baiknya skornya berapa, semakin besar skornya berarti semakin baik. Itu adalah salah satu dari instrumen dalam untuk melihat kemampuan lutut kita. Di saat melakukan prehab ditemukan bahwa hasil dari instrumen KOS tersebut ternyata lebih baik. Seperti itu. Setelah dokter merekomendasikan ke fisioterapi, sebenarnya bisa dibantu juga karena basicnya adalah strength training, kata Charm tadi. Jadi, tapi kita kenapa fisio itu bisa lebih membantu klien untuk memanage prehab, karena fisio itu belajar dan mengetahui basic mengenai manage symptoms dan secara medis dan lain-lain. Seperti itu.
Oke.
Okay. Kalau ada pertanyaan, silakan teman-teman.
Ada yang bertanya, silakan bisa chat atau bisa nanya. Oke, Cham.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, so, lanjut. A study where there is a progressive 5-week exercise therapy program leads to significant improvement in knee function early after ACL injury. So, that's what I'm saying earlier, though, that those who underwent rehab has better functional outcomes after ACL reconstruction. So what are the goals of treatment for prehab? Of course, when we say prehab, it's either we are preventing the occurrence of injury, or if the patient is already injured or in acute phase, we are preparing them for surgery. So the goals of treatment are mainly eliminating swelling, improvement of functional strength, achieving near full range of motion, and improving balance and proprioception. So those are the primary goals of prehab. We should address each one of the following. So what are the components of prehab? When we say prehab, since we are preventing injury, we're not just talking about physical exercises. In physical exercises, we can actually handle that phase. But since we are preventing injury, there are several factors that can prevent injury. For example, nutritional support. If the patient, if we are doing appropriate physical exercises, but there is an adequate nutritional support, do we think that we are going to prevent the occurrence of injury? Of course, no. Okay, so the patient should be able to have proper nutrients for the for faster healing. Medical optimization. When we say since prehab is not just limited to orthopedic cases, who have like cardiac problem or abdominal, or those who will undergo abdominal surgery, they need to have a proper medical status. Like for example, if they have good BMI, if they don't have like hypertension, if they don't have anemia or etc. Because we're preventing, even for surgery, doctors are screening them if they are appropriate candidate for surgery. Those who are having cardiac problem or hypertension, their blood pressure should be controlled. And those who are having, for example, anemia, low red blood cell, they should have, they are expecting to have blood loss after surgery. So they should have normal laboratory values. Especially also, we should include psychological support. Even if we have proper physical exercise, yeah, if the patient is fit medically, even if he or she is achieving proper nutritional support, if he or she has anxiety or fear, for example, of participating into his sports, or if he or she has fear participating into exercises, exercising after surgery, that will be affect the outcome of prehab. Okay, so all of it, we should address it. Psychological, physical, medical, and nutritional support. Those are components of prehab or injury prevention. So for acute phase, I divided phases of prehab into four phases. So we have the acute phase. So since one of the goals for for prehab is eliminating acute symptoms, so what are the usual symptoms of an acute injury? Those are swelling, pain, limitation of movement, and fear of movement, right? So we have to treat the acute symptoms. So pain and swelling management. For example, if the patient has knee injury, so it occurs, for example, this applies to all musculoskeletal injury. If he or she has an injury, of course, there is swelling, especially if it's an acute case. We have to address first the swelling, and that is through icing. So icing for acute injury, and then pain management, range of motion exercises. Because, for example, if the patient has limitation of movement on his knee, if we didn't address that limitation of motion, that will be our problem after surgery. That will be already stiff after surgery. Expecting surgery, after surgery, there is pain because of the surgical wound, right? If he or she has a previous limitation of motion, that would be greater after surgery. But if we address it already, the mobility is better already before surgery, then after surgery, you will expect that the patient has more mobility. So we should address mobility first. Actually, near or normal range of motion is one of the goals of rehab. It's very important. For swelling management, as we all know, if there is a swelling, there is an accompanied pain. Also, there is an accompanied loss of muscle activation, because there is a certain amount of fluid wherein if the muscle perceives it, if our brain perceives it, the muscle will not contract that properly. That's why we are addressing swelling. Even if we do strengthening, but if there is swelling, if there is pain, your brain will signal your muscle, it will not contract or activate properly. So we should address it first. Okay? And then strengthening of the muscles of the joint above and below. Of course, that is very important. For example, if I have shoulder injury, should I just exercise my shoulder? No. We can exercise our back or scapular muscles to have more shoulder stabilization. And then we can exercise our forearm, our elbow. And for the knee, we are also, we need to strengthen the hip and the ankle as well, because that will be supporting your injured joint after the surgery. So not just the joint affected, but also the joint above and below. Okay? And then initiate balance and proprioception. Of course, for an acute injury, balance is impaired, especially if the pain, if the patient is perceiving pain, or if he or she is afraid to move. So we should train the balance as well. And also gait training, because one of the goals of rehab is for patient to be more functional. Okay? You have questions so far?
Ya, ada pertanyaan sampai sini. Fase 1 untuk akut. Silakan ada yang mau bertanya, nanti dibantu sama Rayi buat ditanyain ke Cam atau langsung. Silakan. Langsung dibuka aja ininya, mute-nya. Halo, semuanya. Rayi, mungkin di itu dulu, Rayi. Di summary dulu sebentar.
Oke. Okay. Jadi tadi kita membahas mengenai buat apa sih rehab itu. Yang pertama adalah eliminate swelling atau menurunkan atau menyembuhkan si bengkaknya dahulu. Lalu improve functional strength-nya, kekuatan dari functional movement-nya dia. Lalu yaitu mendapatkan range of motion atau lingkup gerak sendi yang menuju optimal atau full. Lalu meningkatkan keseimbangan dan propriosepsinya. Ada komponen-komponen yang telah Charm jelaskan tadi, yaitu ada 4. Dari salah satunya adalah physical exercise. Tapi physical exercise ini tidak bisa berdiri sendiri, melainkan harus dibantu dengan dukungan dari nutrisinya. Yang kedua adalah medical optimization, ya. Jadi dari dia sebelum surgery, setelah surgery, atau waktu dia cedera, kita harus tahu salah satunya adalah kita harus tahu laboratori hasilnya, dia normal atau tidak, dan lain-lain. Apakah dia punya riwayat penyakit dahulu, seperti misalkan diabetes, atau misalkan hypertension, dan lain-lain. Yang terakhir yaitu psychological support. Apakah dia rasanya takut untuk bergerak, menurun kepercayaan dirinya, dan lain-lain. Itu sangat penting untuk menjadi komponen kita dalam melakukan prehab. Dari phase yang akan nanti Charm lanjutkan, ada 4. Yang pertama yang sudah dijelaskan adalah fase akut. Fase akut di sini adalah fase utama setelah dia waktu dia perlu untuk kita lakukan prehab tersebut. Apakah setelah injury atau sebelum, apakah dia perlu untuk surgery atau tidak, yaitu salah satunya adalah yang pertama pain dan swelling, nyeri atau dan bengkak. Kenapa? Karena nyeri dan bengkak ini akan mempengaruhi lingkup gerak sendinya dia, cara bergeraknya dia. Makanya ini jadi prioritas utama kita untuk melakukan rehab tersebut. Yang kedua adalah lingkup gerak sendinya atau range of motion-nya, karena mobility atau mobilitas, kemampuan sendi untuk bergerak sesuai dengan lingkup gerak sendinya, itu sangat penting sekali untuk kita lakukan gerakan-gerakan yang menuju kekuatannya dia dan persiapan dia dan lain-lain. Lalu neuromuscular activation, jadi kita lalu aktivasi saraf dan ototnya juga. Selain itu strengthening, penguatannya tidak harus selalu ada di sendi yang terkena cedera. Misalkan charm kenanya di shoulder atau di bahu, tidak selalu harus cuma di bagian bahunya saja, tapi juga perlu diberikan kekuatan di back-nya atau punggungnya, di bagian belikatnya, scapnya dia, dan lain-lain. Begitu pula kalau misalkan lututnya yang kena, tidak selalu otot-otot lutut saja yang kita beri latihan kekuatan, tapi juga di bagian pahanya, hip-nya, atau di ankle-nya juga, di bagian pergelangan kaki. Yang terakhir yaitu initiate balance, karena kenapa? Keseimbangan itu sangat jadi impaired atau jadi terkena juga kalau misalkan ada injury di situ, jadinya dia kemungkinan akan menurun keseimbangannya, proprioceptionnya atau rasa geraknya juga. Yang terakhir adalah gait training, jadi perlu kita kasih train untuk berjalan kembali ke normalnya dia, seperti itu.
Okay, Charm.
You may continue, Charm.
Thank you. Okay. So since we have four phases, since I have like four phases for prehab, we will go to the next phase, and that is the anatomic adaptation. So for phase one to go to phase two, there should be criteria, right? Since we are expecting that prehab is only up to 6 to 8 weeks, we are going to shorten the strengthening phase. I mean the whole periodization phase into 8 weeks. Okay. So before we transition to the phase two, we should have acquired normal range of motion, normal or near to normal range of motion, no to minimal swelling, no pain or minimal pain only before we go to the phase two. Also, the patient should have a normal function already, like gait or ambulation, good balance, before we transition to the anatomic adaptation. Since we are going to anatomic adaptation, we are expecting that there's no more pain or limitation of movement. We can start to strengthen the surrounding tendons, ligaments, and joints. Anatomic adaptation, this phase is required to all strengthening phase, because here, our goal is not to achieve immediate overload, but to elicit adaptation of the structures. If we go to strengthening phase and if we overload the muscles already, if the structures like the tendons, ligaments, joints are not repaired, we can just acquire injury, and we are preventing that to happen. That's why we have anatomic adaptation. So even in periodization, every rehab, they should have an anatomic adaptation. Okay. So one of the physiological goals is also to increase bone and mineral content and proliferation of the connective tissue. So here it's just anatomic adaptation first. That's why anatomic adapt. The term adaptation is that we are preparing your structures, your body for further training. So we are not going to overload your muscles, tendons, ligaments, and joints here. We just want them to make them feel, to make the feel of going to strengthening. Okay. So for anatomic adaptation, we just have like body weight exercises. Examples of body weight exercises. So assuming that we have a lower extremity patient who injured one of his major ligaments and he will undergo prehab, he or she can do wall squats. Okay, since this is just body weight, there's no much tension or overload to the muscles. Step ups exercises, calf raises, and then proprioception. For proprioception, we can do weight shifting and then transition to single leg stance, and then single leg stance on bosu ball or single leg stance on wobble board. And then we can also address cardiovascular endurance by using bicycle ergometer or elliptical. So since we are preparing our tendons, our ligaments, and our muscles for this exercise, mainly the tendon, for anatomic adaptation, we actually use mostly isometric type of exercises. Asymmetric meaning there's like hold. Okay. So for a tendon to be trained or to be strengthened, you should have at least 30 to 70 seconds hold per set. Meaning, if you are not doing isometric or hold exercises, or when you say isometric, there is no movement. You just need to hold the joint for a specific angle. If you are not doing that, then you're just loading the muscle. For you to load the joint, you need isometric contractions. And according to one of the books that I read, between 30 to 70 seconds per set for you to load the tendon. For 30 to 70 seconds, assuming that you are doing 10 repetitions, you are holding the joint in a specific position for 3 to 7 seconds for you to have an effect on a joint. So that's one of the training for anatomic adaptations. That's where we're using isometric exercises, okay, for you to load the joint. And there should be muscular balance between the agonist and the antagonist muscle. For example, for your knee, are you just going to exercise your quadriceps? Of course not. You need to exercise your hip muscles, your hamstring muscles as well. So there should be a muscular balance. Okay? Any questions for anatomic adaptation?
Okay, silakan. Ada pertanyaan, teman-teman?
So just think of any bodyweight exercises like split squats, wall squats, step ups, calf raises.
Okay, Rai, silakan. Rai.
Okay. You can progress from double leg. For example, for phase one acute management, you can do 1 week of acute management addressing the pain and the swelling. For phase two anatomic adaptation, you can do it for 2 weeks. Okay, so 1 week double leg, and then after double leg anatomic adaptation, you can transition to single leg on the second week. Okay, so now you have 3 weeks for prehab. Okay, and then the following, I'll explain it later.
Okay, Rai, silakan. Sumeri, Rai. Rai. Baik, halo. Oke, teman-teman yang mungkin ada pertanyaan sampai ke fase 2 anatomic adaptation ya. Jadi ini fase yang gimana? Rai. Oke, Rai. Rai lost connection, nggak apa. Jadi buat teman-teman ini di fase 2 ini adaptasi anatomi itu harus memang sudah tidak ada pain. Tidak ada swelling, ya kan, dan kalau bisa sudah full range of motion. Di mana di sini kita latihan-latihannya akan banyak body weight exercise ya, dengan kontraksinya yaitu isometric, jadi ototnya bekerja tapi sendinya tidak bekerja. Di mana beberapa gerakannya, contohnya adalah misalkan wall squat, step up, calf raise, juga teman-teman bisa tambahkan proprioceptic exercise. Misalkan dimulai dari weight shifting ya, kita bergerak kiri ke kanan, apa perpindahan dari apa namanya beban tubuh ke kiri ke kanan. Habis itu kita bisa melakukan dengan single leg stand, berdiri satu kaki. Setelah bisa dengan single leg stand, kita bisa tambahkan komponen balance di single leg stand, seperti kita menggunakan bosu, juga kita bisa gunakan, atau wobble board. Jangan lupa juga kita harus melakukan cardiovascular endurance, ya kan? Kita bisa melakukan dengan menggunakan misalkan sepeda statis atau elliptical. Nah, di mana jangan lupa juga bahwa otot itu bekerja adalah agonis dan antagonis. Jadi bukan hanya teman-teman hanya melatih saja, ya kan, dari si otot, misalkan hanya otot quadriceps saja, tapi harus juga otot di hip, di glute, dan juga di hamstring. Nah, di mana ada beberapa tahapan, ya, di minggu pertama, teman-teman bisa lakukan dengan double leg, jadi dua kaki. Nah, setelah di minggu kedua, itu kita akan coba latihan dengan single leg. Jadi, total dari 3 minggu untuk fase anatomi adaptasi. Oke, Rai? Oh, Rai masuk lagi. Oke, Charm? One question from Iqbal for condition post-op SCL and meniscus. When we can give the weight bearing, full weight bearing, or weight shifting, or wall squat? When we can?
Is that after surgery?
Yes, surgery after surgery.
After SCL. Surgery, yes, because it depends. If it's pre-surgery, there's no restriction. But if it's after surgery, some doctors they will recommend up to 6 weeks. Just toe touch or partial weight bearing, but not all doctors But not all doctors require non-weight bearing or total weight bearing. So it depends on the protocol. But mostly there are, according to journals, they're limiting the full weight bearing up to 6 weeks.
6 weeks, okay.
Yeah, but for me, since our doctor here, he can actually just put more of an immobilizer and they allow the patient to walk. Okay, already without restriction. So it depends on the protocol of the doctor. But for the meniscus injury, the most important is the range, I think. Because I handled athletes with different protocols with the doctors. They just have outcomes are just the same, but all protocols require the meniscus patient with ACL surgery to limit the range of motion up to 90 degrees for 3 to 4 weeks. Lock the knee up to 90 degrees. Because past 90 degrees, you can already put stress on the meniscus. Because as we all know, meniscus, it's not really, it doesn't have a good supply, especially if it's the outer portion that it's torn. Because not all portion of the meniscus is vascularized or has blood supply.
Okay, another question, John, is for isometric, how long the we can hold the contraction for target tendon and muscle?
According to the book that I read, it's between 3 to 7 seconds.
But
for me, if the patient can tolerate it longer, I can put it up to 10 seconds as well.
So it's progressive, but right?
30 to 70 second hold per set. So it depends on the number of repetitions you are doing for each set. Okay? So if, assuming if you're doing 10 repetitions, you can do 7 to 10 seconds. Okay? But it depends on the patient. If the patient is already shaking, if the muscles are already shaking in 10 seconds, you can just put it to 5 seconds. If he or she can tolerate it longer, you can progress to higher seconds hold.
Okay. To be continued, John.
Okay. So after anatomic adaptation, assuming that we are done with 2 to 3 weeks of anatomic adaptation, we can go straight to the hypertrophy phase. Okay. So here, we are going to load or overload the muscles. So we are using here the overload principle. So training adaptation only takes place if the magnitude of the load is higher than the habitual level. So in anatomic adaptation, we're just doing more of body weight exercises. Our focus there is just for the muscle to get, or the structures to get feel of the exercises to prepare it for this phase, for the succeeding phase. So for hypertrophy, you're going to overload the muscles by doing by heavier weight or heavier poundage, by doing lesser repetitions, and then by incorporating longer rest between each set. So for hypertrophy phase, you need the volume there and the volume to be enough and the load to be enough. Also, the rest is important. We cannot just because some patients, they're carrying weight, but what they're doing is that they will continue the exercises. Like for example, each set there should be like 2 minutes rest or 1 minute rest, but they are not resting because they want to finish further. And then if they're doing that, if they don't have an adequate rest for the muscle, then they are just doing high repetition exercise, which is for endurance. For hypertrophy phase, for this strengthening phase, we need higher force, lesser volume, meaning lesser repetitions. Okay? So we cannot just force the patient, or we cannot just allow the patient to do multiple volumes for them to finish the exercise, because the purpose will be different. That will be for endurance. And for hypertrophy, we need the muscles to get stronger and to get larger. Okay? So they need rest intervals between sets. So for hypertrophy, for example, for lower extremity cases, we can use double to single leg press. We can also use weighted leg curls, weighted calf raises, weighted squats. Then you can progress it from double leg to single leg. So speed squats, it is a great transition exercises for double leg to single leg. If the patient cannot do single leg immediately, then you can do split squats. Okay? And then weighted step ups, deadlifts, and lunges. So if you want to achieve hypertrophy, it should occur actually 6 to 8 weeks. But since we're just doing prehab, just have 8 weeks for prehab, and we cannot expect the patient to consume the whole 8 weeks for this hypertrophy phase, right? So as after this phase, you just continue to load the muscles. Load it heavy, load heavier weights as long as the patient can tolerate it for overload principle to occur. Any questions?
Okay, Rai, bisa summary dulu?
Rai? Ya, mohon maaf tadi sinyalnya, jadi saya keluar dulu. Jadi tadi bahas tentang phase 2 dan phase 3 ya. Di phase 2 kita membahas mengenai tentang anatomic adaptation, yaitu adaptasi anatominya kita secara tendonnya, ligamennya, atau sendinya. Jadi goalnya itu bukan untuk overload weightnya, bukan bebannya, melainkan untuk beradaptasi dengan beban tersebut yang nanti akan kita lakukan di phase yang ketiga, yaitu struktur-struktur jaringan-jaringan seperti tendon, ligamen, dan sendi-sendinya. Nah, salah satunya adalah untuk meningkatkan mineral-mineral di tulang kita juga. Jadi membantu untuk mampunya si sendi itu bergerak dan heal lebih baik, recover lebih baik. Nah, bagaimana? Yaitu satu, beban, latihan beban, bodyweight exercise, misalkan bisa wall squat, atau misalkan step up, atau misalkan calf raises yang naik turun betisnya itu ya, kaki ankle-nya ya. Lalu kedua, proprioceptivity atau rasa gerak sendi. Misalkan weight shifting, jadi satu kaki menuju ke kiri atau menuju ke kanan, atau misalkan satu berdiri di satu kaki, di daratan rata maupun di atas hoverboard. Di latihan buat keseimbangannya juga. Lalu yang ketiga adalah cardiovascular endurance. Jadi kita melatih juga kardiovaskularnya. Misalkan di setting the cycle. Nah, untuk tendonnya sendiri, ini kata Cham tadi yang Cham baca adalah kita hold untuk tendon ya. Kita latihan itu 3-7 detik ya untuk ditahan. Tapi untuk pasiennya itu kadang-kadang atau kliennya bisa masing-masing ada kemampuannya sendiri-sendiri. Tapi menurut Cham tuh bisa up sampai 10 detik seperti itu. Dan 10 repetisi per set. Dan ini latihannya isometrik. Isometrik itu tidak ada perubahan gerak sendi. Jadi ditahan tidak ada pemendekan otot atau pemanjangan otot. Tapi di satu posisi sendi saja. Jadi menahan. Lalu untuk muscular balance, latihan ototnya agonis atau antagonis. Agonis itu latihan otot yang memang dia kerjanya sebagai prime movernya, yang ngerjainnya. Sedangkan antagonisnya itu lawannya. Jadi kalau kita mau latihan lutut yang depan, quadriceps nih, kita juga perlu latih otot-otot pahanya, hamstringnya, dan glutes-nya, dan lain-lain. Lalu di fase ketiga, ini baru ke hypertrophy. Tujuannya yang penting di sini adalah untuk membuat otot kita lebih besar masanya dan lebih kuat. Nah, ini biasanya 6-8 minggu. Tapi itu kalau yang hypertrophy yang sudah selesai. Kalau untuk prehab-nya itu kita nggak bisa expect untuk 8 minggu. Jadi, kita ikuti aja dia perlu berapa lama. Itu setiap orang dan klien sesuai protokolnya beda-beda. Lalu, prinsipnya di sini adalah overload. Jadi, menggunakan volume atau weight yang sesuai sama yang dimampukan oleh si klien.
Oke.
Okay. Dilatih itu kurang ini. Sudah?
Oke. Okay. Terus dikit lagi, Cam. Ya. Itu apa namanya, Rai?
Ya. Kalau 2-3 menit kurang mereka masih bergerak segala macam, itu tidak benar-benar istirahat. Jadi harus benar-benar istirahat baru lanjut lagi. Kadang-kadang orang klien kita pengen banget untuk melakukan lagi dan lagi. Harusnya ada rest-nya.
Okay.
Nah, untuk lower extremity itu ada basic, misalkan leg press, leg curls, lalu calf raises itu bisa dibantu dengan latihan squat-nya, step up-nya, deadlift-nya, dan lunges.
Okay.
You may continue, Charm.
Okay. So here, as I just mentioned, you can start loading patients with exercises with heavier weights. Progressive. The duration again is around 4 to 6 weeks. Then we have the last phase. Because for prehab, we can opt the patient to go to non-operative management. So for us to test the patient, he or she needs to undergo plyometric exercise. Okay, so for plyometric exercises, this is the power phase, wherein the patient can do counter movement, non-counter movement, jumping, hopping. Hello?
Yeah, hello.
Yeah. So here, this is an example of a plyometric program for ACL patients that we're doing. So we can have counter movement and non-counter movement jumps. I'll show you later.
Halo, Cam. Oke, Cam.
Ada pertanyaan ya tadi?
Ya, tadi ada pertanyaan.
Dari Angie.
Nanti. Biar dia jelasin dulu aja, baik. Nanti ya. Pertanyaannya kita pull di Q&A.
Oke. Okay.
Dia kayaknya mau puterin video ini, masih nge-hang. Oke, yang lain teman-teman sambil nunggu silakan yang ada pertanyaan langsung ketik di chat, nanti kita akan bahas saat Q&A berkaitan dengan prehab ini, suatu materi yang sangat menarik karena selama ini kita kadang bingung bagaimana kita bikin programnya, medisinnya seperti apa, apa aja yang dibutuhkan. Jadi ini udah diringkas ya kan dari fase-fasenya seperti itu. Sebenarnya ini juga bisa digunakan di fase rehab juga ya kan. Jadi memang ada urutan-urutannya, kita nggak bisa tiba-tiba langsung latihan, misalkan langsung latihan gym gitu, nggak bisa. Jadi memang harus bertahap latihannya, makanya kenapa ada yang dimulai dari isolate dulu, ya kan, dari satu persatu grup ototnya, baru nanti kita latihannya bersifat compound, lebih dari satu grup otot, gitu yang latihan. Chang? Are you okay? Wait, saya telepon Chang dulu. Chang. Oke, bentar. Cam keluar. Oke, yang lain yang mau ngomong, silakan. Sambil nunggu Cam. Mungkin Cam kayaknya koneksi. Dia lagi mau nyoba untuk masuk lagi sebentar. Oke.
It's 9 o'clock.
Teman-teman ada yang mau ditanyakan dulu nggak yang berkaitan dari awal sampai akhir tadi biar nanti kita bisa bahas. Gaby, kenapa Gab? Silakan Gab. Gaby ngangkat tangan. Halo Gaby. Mana Gaby? Gaby. Halo Gaby.
Boleh sih. Ayo aja deh.
Apa aku satu sini? Sabar ya teman-teman, masih proses connecting.
Mas, aku boleh nanya nggak pertanyaan awam karena aku bukan fisioterapis?
Boleh, 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 silakan.
Boleh ya, aku boleh. Dari point of view blue ballet aja ya, karena biasanya kalau murid aku sakit, aku langsung suruh mereka ke fisioterapis. Aku kan tidak punya pengetahuannya okay. Ya okay. Untuk menyembuhkan mereka. Jadi sebenarnya prehab ini sebelum injury atau minor injury? Waktu ada minor injury atau discomfort? Atau sebelum ada itu semua?
Oke, jadi kalau misalkan kita berbicara soal tadi konsep prehab, jadi prehab itu kan sebenarnya bagaimana kita mengurangi resiko cedera. Ya kan? Nah, jadi sebenarnya prehab sendiri nantinya akan berhubungan dengan movement. Nah, movement itu kan sebenarnya komponen dari movement itu adalah mobility dan stability. Jadi kalau kita berbicara soal mobility adalah bagaimana dia bisa melakukan gerakan sesuai dengan range of motion-nya. Tapi kalau stability itu bagaimana dia bisa melakukan gerakan tapi yang terkontrol, seperti itu. Nah, gimana flexibility? Jadi kalau flexibility itu adalah bagian dari si mobility tadi. Jadi kalau kita ngomong fleksibilitas kan kita berbicara soal ototnya saja. Tapi kalau kita berbicara mobility, kita berbicara tentang bagaimana sendi itu bekerja. Nah, makanya kan banyak orang kan selama ini banyak yang beranggapan bahwa oh ya udah kalau gitu cukup stretching aja itu akan mencegah cedera. Padahal sebenarnya jika kita hanya melakukan stretching itu tidak mengurangi resiko cedera. Seperti itu. Jadi kenapa konsep prehab ini bisa dikembangkan? Karena prehab sendiri itu merupakan salah satu program pencegahan cedera yang bisa kita sesuaikan berdasarkan contoh berdasarkan aktivitasnya, berdasarkan olahraganya apa. Jadi benar-benar kayak tiap-tiap orang itu bisa atau tiap-tiap apa namanya tiap spesifikasi itu bisa melakukan sendiri. Nah, makanya kenapa kita harus mengenal dari misalkan contoh mungkin kalau Coach Anin di balet misalkan oh di balet akan banyak menggunakan apa namanya fleksibilitas atau mobilitas dari sendi lutut atau ankle. Nah, berarti otomatis akan lebih banyak nih kita memberikan edukasi bahwa misalkan ankle-nya harus dilatih seperti apa supaya dia akhirnya bebannya bisa menerima beban. Seperti itu. Jadi kan yang ditakutkan kan gini, banyak orang kan berpikiran, oh nanti kalau kebanyakan strength training, akan badannya jadi kaku gitu misalkan. Padahal sebenarnya sih konsep terbaru itu strength training itu bahkan memanjangkan otot gitu loh. Seperti itu. Dengan cara apa? Dengan cara misalkan nanti ada namanya eccentric exercise dan lain-lain. Jadi not only stretch gitu loh. Seperti itu. Mungkin nanti kita bisa lebih jelas dengan Chong. Oke, mungkin itu Coach Anin ya. Cham sudah masuk. Oke. Thank you. Silakan Charm. Halo Charm. Oke, Charm. Ya. Connection. Oke.
Hi, can you hear me now?
Oke. Yeah.
So for one of the goal of prehab, of course, is for the patient to be functional. For them to be functional, they should know how to proper land mechanics. You can incorporate jogging, jumping, and if you want more advanced, if you are expecting them to opt for non-operative management, you can train them for like hopping, single leg hops, and more power training. Okay, So for that, for plyometrics, for example, for jumps, we have counter movement jumps and non-counter movement jumps. So this is an example of counter movement jump, okay? So you're using the arm swing for you to get the momentum, okay? That's why it's counter movement. You're doing triple extension, that's why you have to extend your arms, okay? And for non-counter movement, you are eliminating your momentum. You don't do shoulder or just like that, okay? And then for you to progress it, of course, from double leg and then to single leg. And then you can do vertical jumping, horizontal jumping, rotational or combination. You can be more creative once if you feel that the patient can already do that, okay? So rotational jumping. So from here, he can like jump by rotating his body 90 degrees and then other side 90 degrees, okay, for rotational jumping. So he can progress the patient for plyometrics if he or she can do it with his or knees stable. So her knees shouldn't be going in. Look also for the foot if it's pronating, if the knee is facing forward. If the patient cannot do like double leg landing with knees stable, or if still his or her knees going in, you cannot progress him to a single leg. Okay, so you should have like a proper progression, and you can also ask the patient if he or she feels any symptoms like pain. Okay. So for training protocols, this is how I usually do strengthening program. Of course, first is anatomic adaptation. And then after that, hypertrophy phase. And then for after hypertrophy phase, if you have more time, you can gain maximum strength by increasing the number, by increasing the weight, and by doing lesser repetition. Here we are talking about 70 to 90% of your of the patient's 1 RM. So maybe he or she can just do 3 to 5 reps and then rest in between and then do it again. Okay, since we are talking about maximum strength. Also, after that, if the patient has maximum strength, he or she can transition to a power type of exercises. That's why you do maximum strength. Because for power, you need to perform a force in a shorter period of time. So you need that maximum strength. Okay, then you transition into power. And then after the power phase, or power endurance and muscular endurance phase, you can go back to maintenance phase by doing regular maximum strength or hypertrophy phase without too much force, just to maintain the strength that you gain for the whole phase. So after your prehab, what are you gonna do? Of course, you need to reassess. If the patient has no acute symptoms, if he or she has normal to near the normal range of motion, if he has basic functions, what are the basic functions? If he or she should be able to walk without deficits, the patient should have good balance, and then functional goal, if your goal is just for the patient to prepare them for surgery, maybe basic jumps and jogging are okay. But if you are expecting the patient for a continuous non-operative management, or if the doctor is asking for a non-operative ACL management, then you can progress the patient for more plyometric exercises like hops. So what's next? Patient, the doctor will need to decide after prehab if the patient will go to surgery, or if the patient will go for non-surgical for conservative management. For example, if after prehab like 2 months or 2 to 3 months, then the patient has stable knees without symptoms, without subjective feeling of instability, maybe he can continue doing strengthening exercises and then not to go to surgery. Because it depends. Because how if some patients are not really athletic or not an athlete, of course, why does she need to go to surgery? maybe he can just go for non-surgical management because he just want to be functional. So that's what I'm talking about. It depends on the future goal of the patient. But if the patient will be doing like contact sports, pivoting sports, of course, the patient should go for a surgical approach. That's why rehab and then surgery. But if the patient doesn't need it or need in the future, he just want to run, to jump, non-contact sports, or just no athletics activities at all, then he or she can go for non-surgical management. Okay? So for functional testing, for example, if after like 6 to 8 weeks or more, like 3 months, non-operative ACL management, you can know if the patient is a candidate for non-operative management if you assess him or her using functional testing, and that is through one of the objective assessment for ACL and knee injuries is HOP test. Example of timed HOP. Okay, so you should observe if the patient's knee is stable and if he or she was able to absorb the landing properly. This crossover HOP. So you're going to check the difference between the distance of the good leg versus the injured leg, okay? Because some doctors, actually some, there are some doctors who are already like saying that surgery is not needed for an ACL patient. So there are some journals saying that those who underwent surgery and those who doesn't underwent surgery, they just have same outcomes. So before you say that, of course, you need to have like functional tests, and this is one of the tests. If the patient knee is unstable, or if he or she feel instability or rotating his or her knee inwards, of course, that's where surgery is an option. Okay. I had like an experience before. The doctor told a football player to undergo rehab first for 3 months, and then after 3 months, he will do functional testing like HOP test, and then he appears to be really strong. He was able to do all the strength training. His form is good. His power is good. But when he did the HOP test, he re-injured his knee. Okay, so because even if you have good muscular strength, but if your ACL is not really able to handle the force of the knee, then that's why surgery is really an option. So he injured his leg during the HOP test. Then the patient, the doctor decided, yes, he is really a candidate for surgery. And of course, he is a football player, so a lot of contact sport and pivoting sport. So instability will really be an issue. So he really needs to go surgery because if the patient is like an athlete, because some patient feels more confident if they have like surgery, right? They will feel like their knee is more safe because they had surgery compared to non-surgery. Okay, so anxiety is really a large factor for the recovery. So single leg balance. So you need to check, of course, the balance of the patient, unilateral stance like this with hands fixed on the hips. Can try with eyes open and eyes closed. He or she should have a stable balance with both eyes open and closed. And then measure the time wherein the patient will land or will step on the other leg because he or she loses his balance. So just best of 3 trials. Okay. So failure if the patient stands or shift his foot. If the opposite foot touches the floor and if his arms wave off the hips. Meaning he doesn't have a good balance. Standing Y balance test. This is also one of balance assessment tests wherein the stance leg, you're going to measure the distance of the front and then back and then the all the distance there in a 6 meter Y. You have to measure same amount of distance between those those line. Okay, so best of three attempts. Of course, while doing balance, the stance leg should be stable. It shouldn't be going in and should be good as well. As well as the distance, it should be uniform between the between each sides. Subjective report, how will you know if the patient has a successful prehab? Of course, there shouldn't be pain and swelling, as you already addressed that on the previous phase, on phase one, heat management. If he or she regained full functional stability, like for example, if he is able to walk again without deficits, or he can do his normal, like, activities of daily living, like ascending and descending stairs, if he is comfortable like jogging or jumping. If he feels that he has normal knee function and a good satisfactory stability of the knee. If the patient feels that still, even after 2 months of rehab, if he still feels that his knee is unstable, then of course he or she should be a candidate for surgery. Because there's still an instability. And then full to normal range of motion and strength. Things to consider, if you are considering an athlete to do surgery or to do non-operative treatment approach, first, the activity of athletes or the activity of your patient. For example, if you have a patient who works in an office and you have a patient who like plays as a football player. Of course, those who works like in an office situation can opt not to go to surgery. Okay, he can just do strengthening like 3 to 6 months. It's okay, just progressive strengthening. But he if he or she is a type of an athlete wherein he does a lot of pivot sports, non-contact sports. Of course, ACL is one of the rotatory stabilizer of your knee. He or she needs to go surgery. And like this, non-operative group was advised not to return to pivoting sports. And then other tears or damages. For example, worst outcomes, if the patient has an ACL with osteochondral lesion or cartilage lesion, of course, if you didn't address the ACL, the stress will be further on the cartilage. So the cartilage will absorb all the forces, all the stress. That's why it will be will lead to more damage. That's why we are considering here if it is just a pure ACL tear or if it's an ACL plus meniscus or ACL plus osteochondral lesions. It's still different. You need to consider that things. Any questions?
Rayi, tolong itu tadi pertanyaan-pertanyaan satu-satu ditanyakan ke Chong. Atau di summary dulu lah ya, summary.
Ya? Oke. Okay. Ya, kita summary dulu ya. Tadi dari, terakhir dari phase 4 ya. Di phase 4 itu ada plyometrics. Jadi dari yang sudah Cam jelaskan bahwa di plyometrics itu ada dua, ada counter movement jam, ada yang non-counter movement jam. Nah, semua yang plyometrics, latihan-latihan plyometrics itu bisa dilakukan dari yang ke depan, belakang, atas, horizontal ya. Gerakan-gerakannya itu bisa dibantu untuk awal-awal itu tanpa beban dahulu. Lalu yang penting adalah si kliennya kita ini adalah functional, jadi berfungsi dengan sesuai dengan fungsi normalnya dia, fungsi geraknya dia yang basic functional movement-nya. Nah, di plyometrics itu juga dibantu sama si anatomic adaptation dan hypertrophy, lalu maximum strength juga kan, sampai ke muscular endurance-nya sampai maintenance-nya. Jadi dari yang pertama, adaptasi anatominya itu yang penting dia merasakan ini, makanya pentingnya di proprioception ya Kang ya, di anatomi adaptasi ini, merasakan bagaimana rasa geraknya tersebut, itu proprioception. Lalu baru ke hypertrophy. Jadi hypertrophy itu latihan benar-benar untuk si ototnya dia, stronger sama larger. Lalu kita kasih maximum strength-nya. Kalau tadi dari penjelasannya Cham, itu 3-5 repetisi, itu untuk maximum strength-nya, untuk repetisi maksimumnya, 1 RM-nya ya, itu 80-90%-nya dari RM-nya dia, 1 RM. Nah, itu setelah itu baru ke fokus ke power atau muscular endurance. Jadi, kita terus dari yang weight-nya dia segitu, dikasihnya, terus dikasih dengan repetisi yang lebih. Lalu, terakhir adalah maintenance. Jadi, dipertahankan dengan latihan tersebut untuk supaya dia tetap bertahan pada kemampuan kerja kekuatannya si otot tersebut. Lalu kita bahas tentang reassess. Jadi setelah selesai semua phase tersebut, kita periksa kembali. Yang penting perlu pertama kita perhatikan adalah tidak ada keluhan-keluhan yang tadinya ada di akut. Seperti nyeri, bengkak, seperti itu. Yang kedua adalah normal range of motion atau lingkup gerak sendinya. Seperti yang sudah dijelaskan Kang Asep juga tadi sama Coach Anin ya, yang penting adalah movement-nya dia, yaitu mobility, kemampuan sendinya bergerak dengan sesuai normalnya, lingkup gerak sendinya, tidak ada keterbatasan, dan stable, dia mampu mengontrol gerakannya. Lalu yang ketiga adalah basic function. Basic function itu adalah gerakan-gerakan normal kita yang basic, kayak misalkan jongkok, dorong, tarik, ke atas, kembali, hanya mendorong ke depan, ke atas, balik ke bawah, ke belakang, dan lain-lain. Lalu balance, keseimbangannya harus baik. Yang terakhir adalah functional goal-nya dia. Dia goal-nya itu normalnya maunya seperti apa. Dari resesi itu kita tes juga. Salah satu adalah hop test dan balance assessment. Nah, dari tes tersebut, setelah itu kita bisa lakukan juga untuk single leg balance. Itu dilakukan maksimal 60 detik menurut Cham tadi. Single leg balance, lalu standing balance test pakai huruf. Jadi kita buat huruf Y seperti itu. Nah, setelah selesai itu semua, kita punya yang namanya subjective report. Jadi laporan yang secara subjektif dari si kliennya tersebut. Apakah ada nyeri, ada bengkak, lalu bagaimana sih functional stability-nya dia? Jadi mau harusnya full kan, tidak ada, kalau jalan tidak ada keluhan, lalu aktivitas sehari-harinya tidak ada keluhan, naik turun tangga tidak ada keluhan, mampu berjalan, jogging, jumping juga. Lalu normal knee function, karena tadi dibahasnya knee, kita ngomongnya tadi fungsi ininya harus juga normal, stability-nya juga harus bagus, kembali lagi juga normal range of motion dan kekuatannya, strength-nya. Yang harus kita pertimbangkan dari semua itu adalah yang pertama activity dari klien kita. Apakah aktivitasnya seperti apa, sportnya seperti apa, itu harus dipertimbangkan. Lalu untuk kelompok yang tidak perlu operasi, tidak perlu surgery, itu tidak disarankan untuk melakukan sport yang pivoting, jadi yang konteks sport yang tadi kita sudah bahas. Karena ada kemungkinan untuk terjadinya cedera berulang atau cedera yang lain. Yang terakhir adalah kita harus pertimbangkan kerusakan-kerusakan yang lain atau cedera yang lain, misalkan untuk ACL. Itu kalau misalkan ada ACL, kita harus lihat juga kira-kira dia ada osteoarthritis kah, atau yang lain-lain kah, apakah cartilage atau tulang rawannya aman kah. Karena kalau ada kerusakan di tulang rawan, sedangkan ACL atau ligamennya itu kena, kemungkinan untuk menghandle force-nya atau menghandle pressure yang ada di lutut tersebut itu akan makin merusak si tulang rawan di lutut tersebut. Jadi itu harus jadi pertimbangan kita juga, sehingga kita bisa membuat program yang lebih baik untuk klien. Seperti itu.
Pertanyaannya Rayi itu masing-masing dari yang awal Udin. Coba ditanya.
Dari NG dulu ya. Okay, Charm, I will read the questions for you. So
Again, sorry.
Charm. Okay. So first questions from Angie. Question is, what's the best weight or for the leg press or the recommended one for leg press for the yeah, what's the best or
the best recommended
weight for the leg press and how many percentage of probably if you could do the percentage, how many percentage of their body weight?
Actually, initially, if you're going to load the patient using leg press initially, you can start using half of his body weight. Just half of his body weight. Like for example, is if he is like 100 pounds, and then you can just start with 50 pounds, okay? But if you are, as you go on, if you are trying to, the patient to jump, he or she should be able to put 1.5 of his body weight. Because there is like a stress in landing, right? So 1.5, 1.5 times his body weight. Because you need to make an allowance for him to accept the force. That's why it's 1.5. And then for single leg, he should be able, one of the goals is to be able to lift his body weight using single leg press. But initially, you can just up to 50% in double leg and then 50% of the double leg weight for single leg press.
Okay, Raji, silakan di proses.
Jadi jawabannya adalah direkomendasikan untuk setengah dari berat badannya. Kalau misalkan jam tuh 1.5 dari body weight-nya dia. Jadi apa? Karena waktu dia loncat dan dia waktu landing dia nggak sama seperti kalau misalkan cuma leg press nggak biasa aja ya. Seperti itu. Apalagi kalau single leg. Itu juga tadi berapa kan setengah ya
setengahnya dari double leg weight
setengahnya dari double waktu weightnya dia yang setengah dari body weightnya berarti setengahnya lagi gitu ya
ya tapi itu progression jadi kalau misalkan dia double legnya udah bagus baru dilatih single legnya tapi akan ya. Dicoba dari setengahnya dari dosis yang double legnya itu seperti itu paling mudahnya seperti itu
iya. Okay, for the next question, Charm, also from Angie. When could we give the leg press after how many weeks and what's the best first weight? Or it's actually being answered, yeah.
How many weeks? As I said, before you, after the anatomic adaptation phase, which is actually maybe 2 to 3 weeks after of anatomic adaptation, you can transition to leg press. Or maybe after a month of rehab or three weeks since the beginning of rehab. It depends. So if the patient has normal range of motion, no swelling, no pain, stable single leg wall squat, stable double leg wall squat, you can start doing double leg press.
Ya. Ya, jadi jawabannya adalah sebaiknya sih 3 minggu, tapi itu tergantung daripada keadaan si kliennya tersebut. Ya, pertanyaan selanjutnya dari Awaludin. Okay. So the next question from Awaludin, Charm. He's asking that what's the difference between proprioceptive and stability?
Training, ya.
Yeah. Sorry, what's the question?
Sorry, what's the difference between proprioceptive and stability? Hello?
Yeah.
When we are proprioception yeah. is specific. Balance like a general term, like wherein you can, it's a general term that there is stability. That's why it's called balance. If you are talking about proprioception, it's more of the joints. If the joints can able to detect the can do stability while it's not in motion. Okay? If you know the joint position sense while it's not in movement. So that's more of proprioception. It's more of in the joints. But balance is just a general term.
Oh, okay. Jadi jawabannya adalah kalau proprioceptive lebih kepada sendinya. Jadi rasa di mana dia merasakan rasa gerakan tersebut. Kalau misalkan balance itu adalah kayak term secara umum aja, jadi rasa keseimbangannya. Tapi kalau rasa gerakannya itu baru propriocepsi.
More of joint position sense.
Yes. Pertanyaan selanjutnya dari Maulidia Hus. How if there's a patient post-operative of ACL and meniscus and
lateral medial.
Okay, lateral medial and with the not full range of motion of knee around 7 months and it's been given exercise for the range of motion but the range of motion is not full yet and still there's a pain. What we have to do?
What is the range of motion first? Is it near to normal range of motion? And what's the pain scale? And when does the patient feel it? We need to be more specific.
Molly, silakan Molly. Molly, tanya.
Mana Molly?
Molly. Mana nih Molly? Ya, Molly-nya keluar malahan. Ya udah, lanjut aja gak apa. Lanjut, Ray.
Okay. Molly's gone charm. So
for that question,
we're going to the next. Next question.
For that question, I can answer it by saying, if you around 7 months, the patient should be started running, right? It is hard if the patient has limitation of motion because he or she will limp. So he needs to address the range of motion. That's why I'm asking if it's near to full range. Okay. Because as long as there is limitation of motion, especially in extension, or a greater limitation of motion in flexion, the patient will limp during running. That's why maybe there's like pain because the knee cannot absorb the force properly because he or she cannot straighten and bend the knee as he runs.
Ya, jadi kita harus tahu range of motion-nya berapa, scale pain-nya juga kita harus tahu berapa nyerinya segimana. Karena itu akan mempengaruhi kalau misalkan kita perlu untuk ke fase yang dia jalan, malah jadi limping atau misalkan nggak bagus gitu jalannya. Jadi kita harus kembali lagi untuk fokus ke sama range of motion-nya dia. Okay, for the next question from...
Aswar.
Do not progress if the patient is still... has limitation.
Yeah. Okay, from Hauser. For the nutritional support for the patient, for example, gelatin nutrition, there is a full of what is it?
Amino acid.
Yeah, amino acid to help for the ligament recovery. And also vitamin C to support the collagen synthesis. And how many percent that the nutrition will, affect the rehab?
Actually, they're saying that if for example, you are in a phase of hypertrophy, you need to build muscle, so you need a large intake of protein. Okay. So as we all know, for an exercise to be really successful, you should have enough fuel, like carbohydrates, and for the recovery for muscle building, you should have enough protein as well. Okay. So we cannot say that a specific value for protein and carbohydrate because it depends on the first. It depends on the age. It depends on the weight of the patient because it is actually computed according also to the weight and BMI of the patient or like how many proteins or carbohydrates.
Yeah, jadi untuk latihan strengthening ya untuk ototnya itu lebih baik diberikan juga bantuan dari proteinnya karena itu membantu juga juga dibantu sama karbohidratnya karena penting untuk
muscle building, of course.
Muscle building.
Protein should be large, like 60% in the whole meal.
60% dari whole meal ya, dari makanannya. 60% protein.
From Anggi. Yeah.
Okay. For the next question from Anggi. For the right landing from jump, is it eversion or straight to forward? I mean, straight ahead like that.
Again, sorry.
Or when we land from a jump, yeah. Landing from jump, which one is the best position for the ankle? Is it eversion out to the outside like that or just straight?
The best position for landing is toe-to-heel landing because you need to absorb the force, okay? So it should come from the forefoot to heel. It shouldn't be everted because if you avert your... if you alternating your foot to absorb the landing, then you might move your knee in an inward position. Okay? Because when you do pronation of foot, your hip will rotate inward. Okay? So it should be like neutral and at the same time, toe-to-heel landing.
Ya. Jadi posisinya netral, tapi waktu dia landing itu toe to heel dari ujung jari sampai ke tumitnya. Jadi landingnya smooth seperti itu.
Ada pertanyaan, dia tanya lagi tuh lagi.
Ya. If there is a mistake, if there is still a mistake, do we have to back to our the previous phase to make sure that the ankle is in the right position or in the right stability and everything.
Just correct the foot. If the patient foot is pronating, then you can try strengthening his tibialis posterior. You can also provide like taping to increase the arch, or if you want the patient, you can like add an insole for him or her to increase the arch if he or she cannot tape his ankle. But if you're always there, you can just tape like low dye anti-pronation taping. But of course, the patient is not always there in the clinic. You can just tell them to offer like an insole, like a arch support or a medial arch support for it to correct. You don't necessarily need to go back to the previous phases. Can address it during that phase.
Jadi tidak harus kembali ke fase sebelumnya. Jadi untuk ngebenerin si ankle-nya itu ya saat itu aja. Jadi menurut Cam itu bisa dilakukan untuk membenarkan form-nya mungkin ya, membenarkan form-nya di fase tersebut. Jadi tidak harus kembali ke fase sebelumnya.
Oke, okay, ada pertanyaan lainnya, silakan. Kirain Mas Awal lagi angkat tangan. Oke. Ayo teman-teman, satu pertanyaan terakhir sebelum kita akhiri sharing malam ini. Silakan, mungkin ada yang mau bertanya berkaitan
Coach
dengan...
Coach Anin mungkin, Coach Anin.
Cam, maybe you can explain to all is every fase, how about the frequency, Cam? It's like 1 week, how many time to training?
For the frequency, you can actually, ideally, it is around 3 to 4 times a week because you need muscle recovery. So like everyday training, if you're just doing the same training for like 7 times a week, it will not be beneficial. Because you need to at least muscle recovery for the muscle to build or repair itself. Okay, so I think 3 to 4 times a week. But if you're doing like, if you want like, you can do like every day if you're training different muscles per day. Like for example, for my day one, I will incorporate more of quads and hip or thigh muscle. For day two, maybe I can focus on core, balance exercises, near range of motion. So it depends on the focus. What we're just preventing is to overload the muscle so that it will not recover. Okay. But for training, maybe 3 to 4 weeks is enough. If you want to increase, it's okay as long as you're not over training the muscle.
Okay, silakan yang lain yang ada pertanyaan mungkin Coach Anin ada yang mau ditanyakan awal. ya kan? Ada komentar, input?
Well, since I'm not a physiotherapist, I can't really apply this to my student because I normally send them to professional physiotherapists. But what can I tell my students if they already have some pain, maybe not really strong pain, they should go through this prehab process too? They're not, maybe some of them are not pre-professional. So some of them are doing this recreationally, but they're like serious students. So they want to keep practicing with the pain, you know, in the knee, for example.
If they already have knee pain, they can go to rehab. But if you want them to prevent knee pain from occurring, you can start doing strength training for them. You can incorporate it like doing strength training before training or maybe 2 to 3 times a week. They should allot a time for strength training. Because once the knee pain is already there, they just need to go to rehab already. But you can prevent it if you are providing like strengthening, mobility training, like that, yes.
There's a question from the chat. From Selvina Belobua, do we have to recommend the client to redo the MRI to make sure that the, for example, the ACL, to make sure the ACL is fine when we want to progress from phase 3 to phase 4?
No need. If the patient has an ACL injury, if it's really torn, it will be really positive in Lachman. The MRI will be the same. It will be really, it will appear torn in an MRI. What we need to do is like the functional stability. If it's more stable, if it feels unstable, and if you do like objective testing like Lachman, anterior drawer, it will still be the same because the ACL is torn, right? So you just observe if there is instability, and also ask the patient if he or she feels instability while doing those activities.
Non struktural macam ya, just functional ya. Jadi we know, yes.
Because it will be the same in the MRI.
Yeah.
In Lachman and Dirdor.
Jadi lebih baik bukan dari gambaran anatomi seperti MRI dan lain-lain, tapi lebih baik kita tes fungsionalnya. Makanya tadi ada beberapa kalau kita mau pindah fase apa aja yang harus dicapai seperti itu. Ya udah melakukan single leg squat dan lain-lain seperti itu. Oke, okay. Ya mungkin thank you Cham for presentation, good presentation tonight. We appreciate it. Thank you for the upgrade our knowledge. Hope you can sharing again next time. Oke, okay. Stay safe in Manila. Oke, okay, buat teman-teman terima kasih banyak buat malam ini sudah datang. Semoga ilmunya bermanfaat. Buat teman-teman dari fisioterapi, dari fitness coach, dari juga lainnya, semoga ini menjadi salah satu pengetahuan baru juga buat kita, ya kan, bahwa memang nggak semua cedera itu nantinya akan perlu operasi, ya kan. Jadi jangan sampai semua dikit-dikit kita pikir harus operasi gitu. Jadi memang ada beberapa hal yang sebenarnya dengan dilakukannya prehab, dia bisa tanpa operasi, tapi pada berbagai kondisi yang tadi sudah disebutkan, kecuali untuk olahraga-olahraga yang non-kontak ya, seperti itu. Jadi yang olahraga permainan, seperti sepak bola, basket, idealnya memang dilakukan operasi supaya ligamennya kembali stabil. Nah, terus juga mungkin bahwa program prehab ini merupakan salah satu yang sebenarnya perlu dilakukan untuk mengurangi resiko cedera. Jadi, buat teman-teman yang tadi mungkin ada dari balet, ada teman-teman yang di sepak bola, ada teman-teman yang mungkin jadi guru olahraga juga di sekolahannya, itu bisa mengidentifikasi kira-kira dari anggotanya ini banyak resiko cederanya apa nih. Nah, disitulah kita bisa melakukan dengan menggunakan prehab tadi. Jadi prehab itu adalah reducing the injury risk, yang dimana sebenarnya adalah bagian dari strength training. Ya, tapi untuk mencapai strength training tadi itu sebenarnya dibutuhkan kita punya mobility, kita punya stability, kita punya movement yang bagus sebelum kita melakukan strength training tadi. Dan juga ototnya adalah dikenalkan kembali atau diaktifkan kembali. Jadi ototnya diaktivasi di fase yang tadi pertama itu di anatomical adaptasi supaya akhirnya ototnya siap untuk dia memberikan stabilisasi pada sendi. Mungkin begitu aja yang bisa kita sharing malam ini. Semoga ada sharing lagi di lain waktu. Terima kasih banyak buat waktunya semuanya. Oke, selamat malam semuanya. Okay.
Thank you, kasih.
Thank you,
Charm.
Thank you for Charm and Mr. Asep.
Yeah, Charm, thank you.
Bye-bye.
Makasih semuanya.
Terima kasih.
Yuk.
Kok bisa gitu? Kok hidupin gitu?
Bye-bye.
Makasih, Mas.
Oke, thank you. Thank you.